Tisdale, the estate.
Good morning, may it please the court. My name is Andrew Fleischman. I'm here on behalf of Nydia Tisdale. And the issues today are pretty straightforward. Just 3 points. Was there sufficient evidence for obstruction? Was the indictment sufficient? Was the jury properly instructed? Let's talk about the case just briefly. Nydia Tisdale goes to a rally. She's been to these sort of things before. She talks to the owner about what she's gonna do. She sits down, she starts filming. An officer asks her to either stop filming, leave, or go under arrest. And according to the officer at trial, what happens next is basically she just did nothing. So the question here is that sufficient to prove obstruction? Under Georgia case law, probably not. Probably the best case to that is Coley, which says that just a mere failure to immediately comply with an officer's
And why is that the, remind me your argument about why is that the question and not what happened after that? I understand she was acquitted on the felony obstruction, but why would the question be that the obstruction is actually when she wouldn't do anything as opposed to what happened in the...
Because of the way it was accused. So it was accused that the officer asked her to leave and she did not comply with his request. That was what happened. Now, if they had accused her of not being arrested quietly, if they said she had resisted after the arrest began, that is a thing which we could talk about what happened afterwards. The only way that they accused that conduct was through the felony obstruction statute. And of course, she was acquitted of that conduct. So I don't think in that case that we look at all the stuff that they haven't charged to try to go back to what they did charge. The only thing she was convicted of here was not complying with the request to leave. And that's it. So.
Now, was the officer dressed in his uniform?
No, he was not in full uniform. He was in khaki pants. He was in a polo shirt that had sort of like a badge sewn on. He didn't have his handcuffs that day. But listen, the jury was told that they had to find that she knew he was a police officer. They were instructed on that. I'll concede for the purpose of this appeal, they found that fact beyond reasonable doubt. Mm-hmm. But what's left here really is whether her failure to immediately comply with this command was enough to be obstruction. And then we have this added detail, the failure to identify. And of course, normally that's not an element of obstruction. But what's confusing here is that the state essentially alleged that Nydia's failure to comply with the trespass statute was the obstruction. That's the confusion in this case, and that's, even in the state's brief, they do seem a little flustered by it. But when what they're saying is, the officer had the authority to ask you to leave under the trespass statute, and you didn't comply, and that's the obstruction. Suddenly, whether or not the officer complied with that trespass statute becomes part of the lawfulness element of obstruction. Did the officer comply? Now here, we have video that was submitted of trial showing Nydia Tisdale repeatedly begging, asking the officer to identify himself. And we have the officer admitting on that video that he did not identify himself. He said, you can find out my name when you read the arrest warrant. So we have that fact, and we can establish based on that that the officer never gave her his name. Never gave him for his identity. Part of the trespass statute, and thus arguably part of whether the officer was acting lawfully in executing that trespass.
Well, does he have to give his actual name if he's, if the fact's been proven that she knew he was a law enforcement officer, does he have to say, my name is Joe Simpson?
Well, Your Honor, there's no case that specifically says what identify yourself means. Though typically, if you were to ask me, could you identify yourself? And I said, I'm a lawyer here to argue with the Court of Appeals. You would say, I haven't identified myself. I haven't given you my identity, which is to say, my name. And typically, when we construe criminal statutes, we construe them in favor of the defendant. After all, it's the state that drafts them. And if there's an ambiguity, that ambiguity cuts in favor of the defendant. As far as I can tell, there is nothing to cut through that ambiguity in the statute to suggest that simply saying, I'm a police officer is sufficient identification. Any more than it would be sufficient to say, I'm a baker, or I walk dogs for a living. The important thing is whether he gave his identity. And you can see in Jackson, cited in my brief, that police officers are expected to comply with the criminal trespass statute when they ask someone to leave. It is not enough for the officer to simply say, I'm a police officer, I need you to get out of here.
I'm sorry?
It's not enough for the officer merely to say, I'm a police officer, I'm in full uniform, I need you to leave this premises under the trespass statute.
Why not?
Well, because in Jackson, which is a 2000 case from the Court of Appeals, this court held that without proof that he was authorized, without proof that he provided that authorization, the officer did not prove, the state did not prove trespass beyond a reasonable doubt.
She was acquitted of criminal trespass, right?
That's correct. Sure.
Okay, so all we're talking about today is the misdemeanor obstruction.
All we're talking about today is whether the officer was acting lawfully when he told Nydia Tisdale to leave, which would mean whether or not he complied with the legal requirements to tell someone to leave a place, which apply equally to police officers and any ordinary citizen. So the second issue we have here is the indictment. So the interesting issue here, and I haven't seen a case that directly addresses it, is what do you do with an indictment that squarely alleges all the elements of the statute, which this one does, but then when it alleges its facts, alleges facts that wouldn't suggest that you've actually met all the elements. For instance, what do you do with an indictment that says, Nydia Tisdale committed murder, she killed someone with malice aforethought, when she stole a French fry from McDonald's? Okay, well, at that point, you have to look and say, does that indictment truly allege the crime of murder, or do we look at the facts that are alleged? How do we decide what happens? Because typically, when courts look at indictments, they don't look merely at the top line of what statute is alleged. They look at the facts alleged and see what it would constitute. Here, Nydia Tisdale was convicted of not complying with the request to leave from an authorized representative of the homeowner. Something that's, once again, strongly suggests that it was the trespass statute that was alleged. Finally, I want to talk about what I think is the most troubling part of the case, which were the instructions in this case. Now, the jury was told they have to consider each count independently, not to consider one count to determine whether the other ones apply. And they were also told that it was irrelevant whether Nydia Tisdale was committing trespass. All that was relevant is whether the officer had probable cause to arrest her. And the jury was told that the only knowledge requirement required under the criminal under the obstruction statute was the knowledge that the man was a police officer. But under that set of instructions, Your Honor, if a police officer approached me today, right now, and told me to leave, it would be irrelevant whether I reasonably believed I had a right to be here and to argue. All that would be relevant is whether I believed he was a police officer. And of course, in Green v. State, cited in my brief, this court squarely held that the state must prove as part of its case the knowledge that the command was lawful, not merely that it's a police officer giving that command. So in Green, of course, a man fled out the back window to avoid police officers, and it was not his first rodeo. It was like his fourth or fifth time when police officers came to his home where he'd flee. His defense was that the officers were not acting lawfully, and so the state brought in the four or five other instances of him doing it. He appealed. He said, it's irrelevant. All I had to know was that it was a police officer. What the Court of Appeals said in that case was, it's not just that you know he's a police officer. The state had to prove you knew who he's acting lawfully. If it's relevant, if it come in as 404B, it is part of the state's case. It is something that they must prove. And here, of course, the evidence that Nydia Tisdale believed she was authorized to be there was quite strong. She spoke to the owner. She had repeatedly filmed these rallies. She spoke to the Attorney General of Georgia, who was representing her in a separate case about filming publicly. She spoke to several of the candidates. She sat up front. There was no complaint. She was served pumpkin pie when she got there. She had a lot of reason to think she was authorized to be there and she had a right. And though a few men approached her to say, you're not authorized to film, you need to leave, the one person who never did approach her was the person she had gotten the authority from in the first place, Kathy Burt. So if the police officer approaches me right now and says, you have to leave, can I rely on the fact that I have a piece of paper from y'all saying you need to come argue? Or do I have to simply take him at his word that I'm no longer authorized to be here? Without that element that I have to know the officer is acting lawfully, truly, I can't ever be allowed to stay in any one place without an officer's permission. And think about the effect this would have as a policy matter on journalists. Journalists often make their bread by filming things as they happen, live. Now, if all the police officer has to say is, you're not authorized to film, regardless of whether that person is authorized, they must shut off their camera in that moment. The film isn't taken, and there's no recovery. We have a statute that requires knowledge so that that reporter can say, listen, I believe myself reasonably to be authorized. I'm going to keep filming unless you give me better evidence.
What effect is it that this was private property as opposed to public?
Well, it means that there's no First Amendment argument. If this were on public property, of course, then I would raise all the 11th Circuit cases saying that, of course, you can film public officials in the course of their duty. Of course, you can film police officers.
And that would certainly be a stronger case.
Absolutely, Your Honor. But here we don't have that element. Instead, we have someone who reasonably believes that they are allowed to film, The jury was instructed that that reasonable belief was irrelevant. How does that affect what happens here? You know, across the sea, there are thousands of people in Hong Kong carrying American flags because they believe our country represents something. What they believe our country represents is more than the freedom to do as you're told. Nydia Tisdale had a right to be there. She filmed because she reasonably believed it was lawful. And for that reason, this court should grant her.
Thank you, sir. All right. Proceed on behalf of the state.